Good morning. Welcome to EduSat Network. Friend, as you know, this week we are trying to understand the early modern English literature. And you know, in the last two lectures, we tried to understand firstly about the Chaucer, then we talked about Boethius and Sarah, and we came to know a great deal about them and about their time, their works. And today we are moving further and we'll try to understand the period, 16th century period, and the great writer, great playwright, great dramatist. And before I tell you his name, I would like to just quote the given by the author. Some are born great, some achieve greatness, and some have greatness thrust upon them. You may guess the author, the writer is the William Shakespeare. We will try to understand his life, his works, and about different sort of the experiment he did in his writing. Like comedies, tragedy, romantic romances, and other sort of the writing. So we'll try to understand different sort of writing he produced, and that the all are the par excellence. So we'll try in different perspective of them. And for discussion on this very topic, we have in studio a scholar and a senior academician, Professor Anand Prakash. He has been teaching English in Delhi University for many years and presently also engaged in writing different sort of works. He writes for academic paper and present his view on different national and international forums. So I think his knowledge and experience will certainly help us and give insight how to read William Shakespeare and how to understand his work. And for discussion on this very topic, we have in the studio also my colleague Ms. Urvashi sitting next to me. She is doing PhD in English from Delhi University and has her own view. So certainly she will also contribute to in our discussion. And also we have in the studio Ms. Geetika Unial. She is sitting next to Professor Prakash. And she has experience in working with media and journalism, so certainly her knowledge and experience will also give us a kind of input to understand William Shakespeare. So I think today's lecture will be more vibrant and will give a different kind of perspective. So with this hope, we request Professor Prakash to start the lecture, and after 40 minutes we will have a discussion. I will also take questions from the media center. So on your behalf, we request Professor Prakash to start the lecture. Welcome, sir.
Thanks, Mr. Amrinder Kumar. And good morning to you, friends. In the previous discussion, I briefly touched upon the use of blank verse in English in the 16th century. I can a little more clearly say that this blank verse was more or less invented by Surrey, the writer to whom I referred in the previous discussion. And this blank verse was invented and employed for translating a great ancient classic, Virgil's Aeneid, which was rendered into English by Surrey in the 16th century. And he didn't know, others also didn't know, that very soon blank verse would be used extensively by all the great writers of English literature from now onwards, from the time that he wrote. And Shakespeare picked it up still more immediately from the contemporary and a little predecessor, that is Christopher Marlowe. So this is important because, as I said previously, blank verse gives a lot of freedom to the writer of verse, a poet. Because otherwise the poet may be stuck with the rhyming. And if that is removed, and this obstacle was removed in English by Surrey earlier and later on by Kidd and others, and Marlowe particularly. So Shakespeare started using it. So this is the point that I thought I'll start with. This will be used by Shakespeare all through his dramatic works. I also, in the previous discussion, touched upon at some length the nature and character of the history plays. And I will just refer to one or two points in brief before I take up his comedies, tragedies, and other plays. In history plays, they are called history plays, but when we now talk about his writings in, under this category, we realize that Shakespeare was in fact talking about the developments of his own time. So they are as much history plays as they are contemporary plays, because when you understood the nuances of the plays and the suggestions that were hidden between the lines, so to say, then we would realize, and Shakespeare's audience would have definitely realized, that Shakespeare was talking about the contemporary issues. And if there were clashes between one lord and another, between the king and the competitors in the court, and if he was showing them with respect to Richard II, Henry IV, and other kings whom he captured in his history plays, then perhaps he was talking about the conflicts of the contemporary period, which were happening on a still greater scale in Elizabethan England. So they are as much history plays as they are contemporary plays. And one can also say that in history plays particularly, because he was talking about the process of history as it emerged and as it unfolded, and as it entered the process of production in a way by people who participated in the drama of history, then we would realize that Shakespeare also brought in, as a very important factor, the English masses. There are certain plays, in the history plays, particularly Henry IV Part II, where he takes the audience to a different place than London, to a different place than the court. And there, you know, the rural England comes out in all its dynamism and its vibrancy. So you have those rural characters, you have Falstaff going there, recruiting soldiers, interviewing soldiers, and in that particular moment, we realize that maybe the kind of misery, the kind of poverty, the kind of deprivation that the masses suffered from, the masses had, that comes out indirectly from this play in particular, and from other plays also, because there are constant references in Shakespeare's history plays to the ordinary people. Having said this, we finished, let's say, the point regarding his history plays. They capture the political process. They are contemporary and political in that sense, and they tell us about how history is made by the great actors, kings, princes, feudal lords, and the masses. And that kind of history gives the plays the particular character that they assumed in his hands. So they are genuinely historical plays. They are not chronicle plays recording, you know, from one time to another, certain important incidents or characters. So then we come to the comedies. And we realize that comedies and histories, as they were written together by Shakespeare, one after another, history plays and comedies came in the last decade of the 16th century. In the comedies, he brought in certain aspects which were denied to him as he wrote the history plays. For instance, in the history plays, he was using folk tales. And these folk tales had already caught the imagination of the ordinary masses and the audiences. And they were quite popular in Shakespeare's time. And Shakespeare was an avid reader and listener. So he must have listened to, must have heard some folk tales from the neighborhood. And he also would have read some of the folk tales recounted either in other works or directly in the books of his time. For instance, there is a play, very early play. This is 1593 or so. There's a play called The Taming of the Shrew. So there is a woman who is very independent-minded and who's very, very assertive and aggressive in her behavior. And some lord thinks that in his marriage, he will tame her. He will control her. He will bring her back to the role that she should assume as a wife. So therefore, he takes on the mission of taming this woman. And it's a folk tale, and towards the end, the woman is tamed. Initially, she gives him a tough time, but then finally, she accepts the role of the wife at home. And Shakespeare ends it there. But then, this must have become a matter of controversy in his time. And this, of course, became a matter of controversy in the last 30 years of English criticism, particularly when feminism arose as an important trend. And people started attacking Shakespeare, saying that he was anti-women, he was showing them as, showing them the place that they should occupy in the overall order of patriarchy, etc. And then the answer was provided by not other critics as much as by the text itself. Well, if you read the text carefully, then Shakespeare is presenting the predicament of the woman and the kind of brutality that she is subjected to. In that brutal atmosphere, a woman has to accept her fate. So Shakespeare is not to blame. What is to blame is the popularity of the tale in the folk tale mode. And he is merely presenting it. But because he is emphasizing brutality, and if you refer to other plays of Shakespeare, he doesn't show this kind of brutality to women, then we realize that he is just presenting a fact. And maybe he's provoking indirectly the audience regarding the kind of behavior they have. Most of the audiences at that time would be males. So he is provoking the audience to think afresh about this issue of the place of the woman in patriarchy and in the family. So this is the kind of argument that emerged more from the text than from feminists. Who also realized later as they read the play more closely that actually Shakespeare had imbued this play with a great sense of irony. So when the woman finally is subjugated, then there are other characters who might sympathize with her and who are not as brutal and as, you know, insensitive to the woman as the Lord Husband is. Therefore, we realize that Shakespeare on the drama is on the theater stage is enacting a scene. That scene will compel the audience to rethink their position about women. And it was a comedy, it ended happily, and the woman accepted, and people must have laughed and clapped that, you know, finally the woman is tamed. But then in their laughter, they might have stopped for a while to think that they were laughing at the wrong issue or the wrong turn of the issue. So it was a comedy, and it has lots of comic scenes there. But I will not talk about all the comedies. I'll just pick up two or three. Let's say there is a comedy that he wrote later, and this is supposed to be, he wrote the comedies I'm referring to. Most of them were written towards the close of the century, and I just pick up Much Ado About Nothing. Now this is a comedy where the characters are women characters are very strong. So this one realizes, and maybe it's a reenactment of the Taming of the Shrew. Because here also there is a woman who is very intelligent, intellectually equipped, very witty. She is the fighting sort, and she will finally become a rebel. This is what the audience will realize later. And in fact, right from the beginning, the way she erupts into a kind of violent dialogue shows that the woman is difficult to handle. And at the same time, she's a comic character. Her name is Beatrice. And the person who is not exactly wooing her, in fact, he's also a hater of marriage, as she is a hater of marriage, which was not the case with the earlier play. So in a way, parts of the play of Taming of the Shrew have been reworked here. So you have a match of wits here between Benedick and Beatrice. And this match continues till the end. And finally, when they marry, immediately after their marriage, they start fighting again. So the whole play is about a fight that began in the first scene. It continued through the play, and at the end, even after marriage, even after they had fallen in love and married, even then the fight continued. So this kind of a witty play only a person like Shakespeare could at that point of time conceive of and present on the stage, and in such a manner that, you know, the battle of sexes finally is won by neither. But the way the woman responds to the wit of the person, that is really remarkable for its scintillating wordplay and the clashing attitudes that the two have. And the play is called Much Ado About Nothing. So why are you bothered about all this? All this means love, all this means marriage, all this means, you know, interacting with a man and all those things. And finally one has to settle. Maybe that is one meaning, but the play finally says not much about anything. And yet, you know, as we watch the action, the drama on the stage, we realize that Shakespeare has in fact touched upon many parts of the reality that surrounds these two characters. Of course, another interesting thing about this play is that it's not a play about Beatrice and Benedick. It's a play about some other characters who are supposed to woo each other and finally who would marry. And the name of the woman is Hero, and the name of the male is Claudio. It is they that the play is about, but in the manner in which Beatrice and Benedict start fighting, the whole play centers on these two characters. So see, within the play, tables are turned. The hero, the protagonists of the play, they become minor characters, and the minor characters assume the role of the protagonists. So this is the kind of experimentation that Shakespeare could do in his comedies. The third is the play that I'll think of a bit in detail is As You Like It. Now, first mark the title of the play. He's not bothered about the titles. In fact, this is peculiar about Shakespeare, that he never says anything through the title. So As You Like It is no title at all. You can give it any name you like. You can interpret it the way you like. And Shakespeare is merely presenting a situation before you. But what is important in the play is the way he selects the situation and presents it before the audience. And then you can form your own opinion, but you have to form your own opinion, keeping in mind the interaction of these characters and the situation in which they are placed and the ideas that they express in the course of interaction. So that's how you can make your own opinion. And Shakespeare is that way, a truly democratic soul in theater, on the stage, where he gives equal importance to all characters, irrespective of where they stand in the society. And yet, he is able to create humor, he can create irony, he can create satire, and he can also create some kind of lyricism. For instance, in As You Like It, there's a pair of Orlando and Rosalind, and you find that they fall in love at first sight, right in the second scene of the play, and then these people continue. But they have no chance, to stay at their places. The boy is, because of the behavior of his brother, has been compelled to leave the home, and he doesn't know where to go. So he's deprived of all his wealth, and he has been turned into a poor person. And the woman faces the same fate. So she runs away, and he also runs away, and they meet again in the forest. Now, why forest is important? In some plays of Shakespeare, you have this forest as not merely an atmosphere, it's also a character. Because the same people who behaved one way when they were surrounded by home, by the atmosphere of the home, the same people turn different when they go to the forest. And of course, Shakespeare, this is, some of you who would have some idea of Shakespeare's writings would know that Shakespeare didn't have in his time women actors. So he would go, he would give, boys, young boys, the role of women. And in this play also, he has given this, he has, because he knew that actually he could not get a woman to play the role of Rosalind. Therefore, what he does is, and this is a remarkable, aspect of Shakespeare, he creates a situation in which the boy will become a boy. The boy actor will become actually a boy, a character in the play. So Rosalind, because she has to run away from home, and she cannot run away safely. She cannot go out safely into the world. Therefore, she puts on the garb of a male. So in the play, the male actor plays the role of a woman, and in the process, the woman turns into a male within the plot, and therefore there is a situation in which the boy is playing the boy's role. So Rosalind is a boy in the play till the end. Only at the end do people know that it's a woman and she has been loving this man. And the lover also didn't know that actually he was talking to his beloved, whom he saw for the first time earlier. So this kind of a play, this kind of a game, this kind of a series of tricks that are invented by Shakespeare on the stage actually showed that, our writers like Shakespeare would find it really challenging to entertain the audience this way. So he's, as I said, with respect to the earlier play, here also he's playing games. Here also he is converting a woman into a man, and the man behaves both as a man and as a woman. Unto herself, she is a woman, unto others, she is a male. Then in As You Like It, you have also certain philosophers. And there are fake philosophers and there are genuine philosophers. And when fake and genuine philosophers discuss things with each other, then the fake becomes genuine and the genuine becomes fake. So why is Shakespeare doing this, that he is ridiculing the philosopher in this play? Perhaps the reason is that Shakespeare, as I also referred to this point in the previous discussion, Shakespeare himself had some kind of a clash with the scholars in his time, who called themselves university wits. So actually, he would not directly answer in a poem things that they said about him, the question that they raised about him. But then when his turn came to write a play, there he would show how philosophers can actually talk as fools. And there's a person called a fool, Touchstone, in the play, who can talk as a philosopher truly. So true and false philosophies, they are put on the same pedestal. And when, well, as the play's title suggests, it's for you to decide who actually is the fool and who is the philosopher. Then, there are sentimental lovers, but is sentimental love good or bad? Should it be appreciated or should it be rejected? Now, Shakespeare, once again, is paradoxical on this point. Yes, human beings have a weakness for love. They want to love, and loving is foolish. But can they avoid it? And Shakespeare knows they can't avoid it. So what does he mean? Does he mean to say that people should love? Because if they love, then they'll be open to ridicule. And if they have to be serious, then of course you can say that they can't be lovers. And there are statements like this in this play and elsewhere also, that so far as lovers are concerned, lovers, poets, and madmen. He makes a category: lovers, poets, and madmen. And then he uses a very good current phrase that was at that time: of imagination compact. Now that's a difficult thing to say. So they have the same kind of imagination. This is what he means. But he uses the Elizabethan use of the word compact. So lovers, madmen, and poets, they are of imagination compact. So here you can see that in action, that the lover is writing a poem, and the poem is a foolish expression of love. And in fact, in this play, if you just read it, and I think all of us should read this play, the lover is writing poems which anybody can write, and which doesn't touch anybody at all. But then he thinks that he is doing a great justice to his beloved by praising her this way. And he writes a poem on a piece of paper, then he hangs that paper on the branch of a tree, and he realizes that if someday that woman would come, then she would pick up these small pieces of paper, and then she would know that he loves her. So this kind of, which means that Shakespeare is not talking seriously. But we realize when we watch the plays that these are the questions that occur to us all the time in true life situations. And then we know that we also perhaps would turn into these kind of figures if actually the same thing happened to us. Now, this kind of a comedy never existed in England. Exceptions apart, you would not say that people will spend 3 hours or so, or 4 hours in theatre, just watching these scenes, which are only loosely connected under a plot. But then Shakespeare became quite popular because of these plays. And here he used wit, here he used humor, here he used entertainment, and more than that, he used dramatic experimentation. So in drama, in theater, he experimented for these things. Are they comedies? Because there is serious issues. The answer once again is yes and no. Yes, they are comedies in the sense that people get a great deal of entertainment from them. And they are serious plays because Shakespeare is raising questions of not merely love and marriage, which are important in themselves, but also questions of patriarchy, family, property, because both the girl and the boy, they had to run away because of issues connected with property and money, because the brother would compel Orlando to leave the home, otherwise he'll share his property, and the woman actually is the princess. So she's the daughter of the earlier duke, who has been dislodged by his younger brother. So she's a threat at home, and unless she's driven away from there, the new duke cannot breathe easy. So you can see that in the background lurk all these important questions of the state, the property, the privilege, etc., money, and on the other side are supposedly universal questions that, you know, this is what love is and this is what marriage is. And towards the end, the couples happily marry. Even the fool in the play marries. The philosopher, Jakes, he doesn't marry. He's against marriage again. But he sees before his eyes that, you know, people make fools of themselves in marriage and yet they enjoy themselves. So this is what the play is. And the last thing I would say about this play is that it redefines comedy. In the sense, you know, that it's not merely jokes, it's not merely entertainment. It's also that there's a kind of a vision there, and the vision is of optimism. So in fact, you should understand this world in comic terms. Comic terms means a place which you like and a place which you would like to change also, in which you would participate and you will change the existing perceptions. So finally, the audience comes out wiser than before, because now they would not hate this world. They would not hate these institutions. They would be alert. They would be critical. But at the same time, they will participate in the process of all these institutions. And then, if need be, then they will, through experiment, change this world. So the formula of Shakespeare is entirely his own. It's an original formula of comedy, where one falls in love, then one waits for the love to finally come to some kind of a crystallization, and after that marriage happens, and that in marriage the lovers meet, and a meeting of lovers in marriage means that the two equal partners in marriage are meeting, so they like each other. So in a way, this becomes a critique of the established institution of marriage at that time, which didn't happen this way. Marriages were decided by the parents, keeping in view the kind and amount of money of dowry that will accrue to the home, to the male. But these men and women, these lovers, they never talk about dowry. They never talk about money exchange. And that's why a new idea is quietly slipped into the consciousness of the audience. So see how many layers, through how many layers the play reveals itself. So I say it's a combination of romance, wonder, irony, drama, and all these things. Now the last play that I'll refer to is Merchant of Venice. There also you have the lovers again, and the lovers will not know till the end whether they can marry each other. And you also have perhaps one of the strongest characters, a woman character in the play called Portia. So Portia will actually pull the strings in such a manner that the issues raised regarding money, property, and other things, they're all resolved successfully. If she didn't intervene, then the lovers wouldn't have been able to marry, and other issues that the poet raised, they also, Shakespeare raised, those questions also wouldn't have been resolved. So one knows that particularly in comedies, it is the women who rule the roost. It is they who are given the most dynamic and the strongest role in life. So I would say that this is a formula that started with Shakespeare, and this continues till today, not only in England, not only in Hollywood, in films, etc., but also in India and other places. And you know that 60-70% of the films which are based on some kind of a drama or conflict, all these things take inspiration from this formula. That the boy meets the girl, that then they have initial obstacles on the way, and finally they marry, and after marriage they are supposed to live happily ever after. This formula is invented for the first time in world literature, and particularly through comedy, by Shakespeare in the late 16th century. I then come to the most important category of plays that Shakespeare gave us. The most important, and I know what I'm saying. The plays that are that have this category are tragedies. They are plays like Hamlet, King Lear, Othello. These are the plays, and in these plays, Shakespeare is exploring a new region of life, a new region of imagination, a new area this area which the ancient writers had touched, but which others were not able to pursue as well as Shakespeare came to in the 16th, 17th centuries. You had, of course, in some serious plays showing contradictions and conflicts in life, themes of incipient themes of, not the actual crystallized schemes, themes, but incipient themes of tragedy. But generally, they revolved around revenge, the question of revenge. Somebody will do something and then he will invite, a kind of response, very violent response from somebody else. And they will both remember that, this revenge is to be taken, and the person who has already done the first hurt will wait for the step of the of the opponent. So revenge was generally used earlier in order to show this kind of a clash. Shakespeare used this revenge tradition to his own advantage and showed its actually a meaninglessness. In fact, revenge, Shakespeare, you'll find a great deal of alternative to revenge. Revenge doesn't solve any problem at all. Revenge, in fact, is creating senseless violence. So he offers a critique of revenge. He discredits revenge as a kind of motivation, and he says that actually people should live in harmony. He doesn't say it directly. He's not a preacher. But then if you analyze his plays, you realize that Shakespeare is working out this problem of people becoming violent in life and finally ending up in some kind of disaster and destruction. But then this revenge can be used as a kind of factor in a play which has a tragic plot. So revenge means a kind of violence, but then if you relate revenge not to individuals or to houses or to families, but to political social structures, after all, where does the idea of revenge emanate from? If you go into this question, then you realize maybe it comes from political conflict, it may come from ambitions, it may come from some economic interests. All these things are actually hidden behind the activity of revenge. If you go into those structures, then you realize that there are moral questions, there are religious questions, there are philosophical questions. And finally, revenge becomes the result of, one of the lesser results of, but definitely the results of the social conflicts at the time. So through these plays, Shakespeare is showing a large number of things, most of them painful. Most of them are, inducing some kind of sense of suffering in people, and answers are not given. In fact, there are no answers in the tragedies. There is suffering, there is pain, and there is a clash of interests of different kinds. What Shakespeare is, particularly in his tragedies, emphasizing is the human motivation. Why is it that human beings behave in a particular manner? Can we examine that behavior? Can we know its rational roots? Can we then say that certain things can be removed because of which the behavior underwent change? So all these issues get raised indirectly in the dialogues of characters who are moving from one situation to another through the comic, through the tragic plot. So how motivations take place? How they get their origin in the mind of the person, in the mind of the people who put pressure on others, and all those things. And then, because this motivation creates a sense of crisis in the play. Most of the tragic plays have a sense of crisis, either in the middle or towards the end. And this crisis cannot be solved. And if this cannot be solved, then the only resolution possible is death and destruction. So Shakespeare is showing that there are certain problems which cannot be solved in life, particularly in Elizabethan period. Maybe today they can be solved, but in his time they could not be solved. Now I'm introducing to you at this stage a particular concept which will explain to us how tragedies finally work themselves out in the hands of Shakespeare. Now you can think of certain contradictions in life. Contradiction is a difficult word, that that there is one thing and there is another, and these two things coexist at this time, but they are fighting all this time. This is the contradiction. For instance, there may be a rich person and a poor person, and the rich and the poor cannot live together. It's a kind of a contradiction. Either they become equal, which means the rich ceases to be rich, or the poor person dies, which means only rich remain, which is not possible. Therefore, this contradiction cannot be resolved easily. And this contradiction then will be called antagonistic contradiction. This is the term I'm using. There is a contradiction which is antagonistic in nature. It cannot be resolved. There can be contradictions which can be resolved. They will be called non-antagonistic contradictions. For instance, if a man loves a woman and it's a question of marriage, then through marriage, and you can go to the parents of both the girl and the boy, and you can tell them that after all, why should you bring in your prejudices when you decide about their marriage? You just let them live as they like. Or if that doesn't happen, then you then they elope, then they run away from there. So either way, the contradiction can be solved. So that's the non-antagonistic contradiction. The antagonistic contradiction is that a king has a new king has usurped the position of the other king earlier. He has dethroned him. He snatched his throne and became the king. Now the two kings cannot coexist. So one has to die. And this is the contradiction in Hamlet, for instance, that Hamlet's father was the king and he was dethroned by Hamlet's uncle, and the father has died in the meantime. He was killed by the uncle, and now because the contradiction has occurred that a wrong person has assumed kingship, therefore it cannot be resolved. The son of the old king will try to somehow take a step so that this present king is replaced by him, or something should happen in order to throw him out. Now this contradiction cannot be resolved. Therefore, towards the end, what will happen is that both people fighting for the throne or fighting in the direction of resolving the conflict, both of them will die. So in Hamlet's case, Hamlet will die and his uncle also will die. In the process, his mother also will die, who married the uncle after the father's death. So there are so many deaths, and it's a kind of a revenge play also. So you see that revenge is given a turn towards a creation of a contradiction which cannot be solved. And because it cannot be solved, the result is going to be death and destruction. Now, is it real? And nobody knows it better than Shakespeare, that this is the reality that is staring in the face of people who are sensitive and who want to solve the problems of life in general. So this realism Shakespeare is able to work out through his plays. And I will give it the name of intense realism. This is a realism that disturbs us from inside. This is a realism that haunts us all the time, and we cannot easily overcome it just in the realm of ideas, because they haunt us all the time. When such contradictions arise and death and doom is the only way out, then can we say that this is a pessimistic world? I am asking a difficult question. Should we be pessimistic in life because it has those contradictions of this kind? Like, in the 19th century, 20th century, the world is such that, the poor and the rich cannot live together. This is a contradiction. But in that case, should we become pessimistic or should we remain optimistic? This is the question. If Shakespeare were pessimistic in his time, in the face of these contradictions, would he write then? He would not write. Writing means that through writing, he is telling us that this thing should be understood as to what it is. And maybe at that point of time, the writer says that this understanding will finally lead us to a possible solution. The solution may be there, but solution may not be there at that time. Maybe after 50 years or 100 years, there will be people who will understand all these things and they will find an answer to this. So this is Shakespeare's modesty, and this is Shakespeare's sense of realism. So it's not that every answer can be given at the time when the problem raises its head. Maybe the answer can be given after 100 years. In Shakespeare's time, the answer came to this, to all these political conflicts that he was talking about. It came to England particularly, and this is remarkable. I'll talk in some other discussion about this. What was, 40, 50 years later, when England beheaded its king, the English society beheaded its king in full public view, and a republic was formed in the late 17th century. So these are the questions that Shakespeare is directly or indirectly addressing. Now, I'll just finish here, because if I take up other things, then it will be difficult to do justice to them. So I say that in his comedies and tragedies, Shakespeare is offering a perspective of life, and that perspective gives us an opportunity to look at the issues that he has raised with great seriousness. So this is Mr. Anand Kumar. Now,
yeah,
you may.
What is the rule from the today lecture is that William Shakespeare was ahead of the time, and he was man of the time, not only in ideas and thinking, but also I think he was in capturing the sentiment, emotion, and the aspiration of the people. So how, and keeping in the mind 21st century, because you saw in film and others, we follow the idea of what William Shakespeare wrote in the century. So how such a classical writer could be, because we have criticism also now coming up about the author of like William Shakespeare or others. So how can we look at, I mean, what angle should we have in the mind while assessing this William Shakespeare's and or the other great writers?
Now this is the difficult question. You know, we are all, you know, students of Shakespeare, scholars of Shakespeare. We are faced with this situation as to what sense we should make today of Shakespeare's plays. Now I cannot answer this question directly, but I can say that Shakespeare now has become more relevant to the underdeveloped world. Okay. Now he is very popular in India, and recently I think there were two or three films on Hamlet itself. Mm-hmm. There is a film called Makbul.
Yes.
If I'm, yeah. So that was there on Hamlet. So there have been lots of films in the third world countries, because here we know that the question that he is raising, they make sense to us. They may not make sense to the developed world,
right.
Because you know there the entire media, all the filmmaking, etc., has gone into the hands of people with money, and the kind of idealism that we have, the third world country citizens have, that kind of idealism is not there in the European audience. So maybe they don't appreciate it as much, as even though there are great Shakespeare societies in every part of the world, and Shakespeare is a popular author, but the way he relates to, mm-hmm. through his plays, our situation, that is not there in the developed world.
Okay, so let us see the younger generation observation. How do you see? Because there was a time when people would get a book of written by William Shakespeare, get happy, and a kind of excitement had come to the mind. Now that everything is available on the net, and you can read it and feel it, but the feeling point, I think, missing. So what do you want to say about the William Shakespeare writing,
sir,
and all this? Yeah, any question, observation, what you want to make from the today lectures?
Okay, yes, sir, definitely I would like to make an observation regarding what sir was talking about today, the comedies. While I was reading a bit, I came across a term which says that his comedies are problem plays. With respect to this term, I would like to ask, sir, is it because he mixes humor and tragedy in his plays? Maybe because of that, such a term has been used.
I actually didn't use this term, but yes, this term has been used. The problem plays, and in fact, the play that I discussed.
Yeah.
The last play I discussed in Merchant of Venice. This,
okay.
can be called a problem play.
Right.
Even Much Ado About Nothing has a great element of tragedy in it.
Yes,
towards the end, you know, the fight has become so intense in Much Ado that Benedick and the other person, they have to fight with each other.
Right.
And the fight is fixed. And one knows that the other person is a better fighter than Benedick. So if that person kills him, then Beatrice and Benedick cannot marry. So the play might end into a tragedy. So in fact, with the passage of time, and this relates to more the environment in which Shakespeare lived. Shakespeare was living in an England which is moving towards crisis. And the crisis had occurred towards the end of the 16th century.
Mm-hmm.
And when the queen was getting old, when she could not, you know, take care of all the issues properly. So that crisis of England was also expressing itself in the plays of Shakespeare.
Right.
Directly or indirectly. And around the time the queen dies, I think 1603, the queen dies, and after that Shakespeare, around that time Shakespeare is writing these tragedies. So there's no direct connection between them, but one can see that the entire country is going in a direction where problems cannot be solved. So
okay.
and because problems cannot be solved, so some plays will be actually getting the name problem plays.
Okay, as you said.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. As you said that William Shakespeare was having clashes with that philosopher of the time. So one thing, his famous quote is, "A fool think himself to be wise, but a wise man knows himself to be a fool." So this was the quote to defend himself, to counter them, enlighten themselves. Why? What this quote was used as a what?
Mr. Narendra Kumar, this is a point that we always keep discussing in our usual talk.
Yeah.
And writers, use Shakespeare's words and his phrases for the titles that they use writing novels, etc.
Yeah.
There are lots of things. In fact, most of Shakespeare's language has entered our psyche. Has entered our imagination, has entered our minds, and we were mostly using knowingly or unknowingly Shakespeare's phrases.
Right.
So, for instance, "Frailty, thy name is woman," and you will see it repeated any time. In a phrase, in an essay, in a book, in a news report, etc. So he's a master of language, and the way he coins words and phrases, and nothing is good or bad. Only thinking makes it so.
Yeah,
it's so apt.
And for writing, it's fine. My question here is, suppose this was because he was in class with the philosopher of the time, of his time. So how can we interpret this? This was you to demolish the philosopher of the time, or just to enlighten himself?
I know this is so far as the philosopher part is concerned. A philosopher is a person who, in an abstract manner, talks about the issues of life.
Okay.
The philosopher is using abstractions, concepts only,
mm-hmm.
and most of the philosophy is academic in nature. It's cut off from life,
mm-hmm.
etc. So a philosopher is generally open to ridicule. That when all other people are fighting the battle of life,
mm-hmm.
the philosopher is sitting in a corner and thinking about it,
right.
And he's thinking in such a manner that he cannot suggest any answer. So this clash between philosophers and authors,
okay.
this is quite genuine in the Elizabethan period. And Shakespeare comes from a small town, and he has come, and he has made it big in London. He has progressed. He is one of the best. In fact, he is in touch with the court. He is asked to present plays in the court for the audience. That is elite audience of the country. So the philosopher writers and others, they will definitely be envious of him.
Okay.
So this clash is personal in that sense, as also theoretical. That philosophers are people who have no practical sense.
Okay, as Professor Prakash said, that we use the quote by Shakespeare's, and in journalistic writing, then we find more of the such numbers. So, Gitka, you are from the journalist background. What is your opinion about this?
I heard, sir, it is clear that he has a philosophical point of view, and through comedies and tragedy, he showcased and presented what he wrote. And that is for the reason, as sir said, about many films in the Indian industry. If you talk about film industry, lots of films have been produced based on his novel. This is Othello. Omkara was produced.
Right.
So do you think to get more perspective into the Indian film industry, more is to be read about Shakespeare?
Definitely, because we as listeners and viewers of films, etc., we should think about different perspectives, and the original perspective comes from Shakespeare, and people feel inspired by what he wrote. So if that is the case, then reading more of Shakespeare would really help us understand these films, and vice versa. If we see these films and then go back to Shakespeare, then we know whether dilution has occurred or distraction has occurred or some kind of displacement of the theme has occurred, all these things. So these questions will come to us, and then we'll be seriously discussing them in a new way.
Okay.
This is how it would be.
Any other thing Urvashi would like to ask to Professor Prakash?
Yes, sir, I'd like to ask you one question. Perhaps it is going to be very useful for the undergraduate students who are watching this lecture. Could you say a little bit about the tragic flaw in the main character in the revenge tragedies, because we've looked at the tragedies by Shakespeare?
Initially, Shakespeare was being compared till the 19th century with the Greek writers, with the writers of Greek tragedies. And there is a Greek critical concept called the tragic flaw. And tragic flaw is actually individual-centered. That somebody has a flaw in one's nature, and because of that flaw, this person makes an error, and that error develops into a kind of trait with him, and he is bringing out about his own downfall. So this is in a way a concept of Aristotle, and this concept was used to understand Shakespeare till the 20th century. In fact, the bigger exponent of this kind of a concept is H.C. Bradley. He used it at length in his book. But then these days we realize that Shakespeare should not be understood through the character, the main character. Because if you just focus upon the main character in the play, then you'll make it an individual case of tragedy, pain and suffering. And in fact, one should read Greek tragedy also, not from the point of view of characters. So we should take our attention away from the main character in order to see the context in which the character behaved.
Okay.
And then if you analyze that context, then of course you know that newer meanings emerge from the analysis of the text.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Another question I would like to ask you, because, and this is a question of general nature, because when we try to understand an author or writer or a dramatist or playwright, we try to understand through the character, his writing or the whatever, in case of the film, through film. So in case of William Shakespeare, when we try to understand him, how better we can understand those three characters, yeah, what was the conflict of his own idea or the conflict of the mind, such kind of personal and personality level. Can you briefly tell about that?
Of course, we cannot keep our eyes off the person who wrote the plays or wrote a particular literary work. But you know, the difficulty about Shakespeare is that very little is known about his life. Nobody can say for sure how he lived and what he said to others. His opinion is not easy to find in the plays, because all the opinions that he expresses are through the characters, and then they make sense to us as coming from those characters, and they can't be ascribed to Shakespeare.
Okay.
So when one character says frailty, their name is woman, mm-hmm. it's not that this person is saying that women are always weak.
Mm-hmm.
So the point is that these plays should be read as literary works who appeal to us, because finally they will help us understand our reality better. And Shakespeare also wrote his plays for the same reason.
Mm-hmm.
He wrote it in the sense that he understood his world in such a manner that he felt like sharing it as a vision with the rest of the audience.
Okay.
So that made him a genuine person, mm-hmm. a genuine writer. So one is not interested in how he lived and when he got up and when he went to sleep and all those things, or whom he met. What is important is that he wrote these plays. And in these plays, mm-hmm. he gave so much of importance to certain characters, and he made other characters talk and give their opinions, so that a kind of clash of opinions occurred. So we should try to understand him as a dramatist,
okay.
as a writer, mm-hmm. Talking about society and bringing in, mm-hmm. it on the stage at that
time. You talked about the contradiction and antagonistic contradiction. So in case of William Shakespeare, we find that appears in one book to another book. But when you follow another writer of the time, later period, Charles Dickens, he writes this way: he was the man. He was the man of idea. He was not man of the idea. He's a man of personal nature. Not man. Such kind of, he contradicts the same thing in the same sentence. So how this shift we find? There is any continuity or the change was knowingly done?
No, what you are saying is that Shakespeare in his time said things, and the emphases of Shakespeare may have changed later.
Yeah.
And how is it that these changes occur? Mm. Is the question.
Yeah.
You know, actually, every age, every time segment in history has its own characteristic. And you cannot say that all times in history are equally, you know, challenging. Some times are more challenging than the others. Dickens's time is the time of, let's call it capitalism, that you know,
mm-hmm.
the cities are becoming bigger,
mm-hmm.
the villagers are flocking to the cities for jobs, etc.
Okay.
And that is mainly common people,
mm-hmm.
who are you know, getting together to fight a force which is itself quite powerful. Shakespeare's period is that one ruling class is trying to replace another class. So for instance, monarchy has come into England, mm-hmm. and it has come after displacing the feudal lords from their individual territories. So when that fight is going on, Shakespeare doesn't know whether to look forward or to look backwards.
Okay.
But he tries finally to see the answer in the clash itself. And in the clash, he realizes that even though monarchy may not be as good as the earlier things and values are changing, but then he knows that monarchy finally will be established.
Okay.
So he accepts this, he may or may not like it. That's a different thing. But he cannot do it. He, as a realist, will always remain at the center of things in the present time. So this is a very important period in England at that time, and Shakespeare comes up to the challenge this way.
Okay. So, well, friends, with this we would like to conclude the lecture, and we'll also like to share a piece of information with you that instead of day after tomorrow, we are going to have a lecture on English literature tomorrow, because the whole day is now on 15th, and tomorrow is, we'll have lecture on this very topic. So I thank all of you for watching this lecture, and on my behalf, I also thank Professor Anand Prakash for giving such an insightful lecture. Thank you very much.